Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. Thank you all for joining us for today's webinar. My name is Hannah Taufikia from the BIBF. Just let me know if you guys are hearing me well so we can continue. Great. I welcome you to today's leadership talks. Today's session is on the challenges and benefits of working from home, an important topic in the current situation. All of us are affected directly and indirectly by working from home, as you all know. This session, presented by Dr. Vijaya Muvala, would help us in understanding the challenges and benefits of working from home. The session will be about 40 to 50 minutes. Questions will be taken by Dr. Vijaya at the end of her presentation. So if you have any questions and comments during the presentation, you can type them down in the comments panel on the right side. Now, without further ado, I hand over the mic to Dr. Vijaya. Dr. Vijaya is the CIPD Program Manager and Lead Consultant in HR at the BIBF. She is a high-profile professional with an outstanding reputation and over 25 years of experience in the region as a management consultant and leadership and development facilitator, corporate researchers, counselor and coach to several HR managers. She published several management and HR related articles and case studies in the international books and journals. She also presented in her research findings and papers in international conferences. Please welcome Dr. Vijaya, over to you.
Thank you, Hannah. Thank you so much for the very good introduction. A very good afternoon to all of you, and again, a very warm welcome on behalf of BIBF. As Hannah rightly said, this topic, work from home, has touched us all in so many different ways. What I'm going to talk today is about the challenges and benefits of work from home. There are a lot of good things and there are certain things which we need to fix right in organizations. Work from home is a novel concept for corporate Bahrain. You know, prior to COVID-19, work from home was considered as a favor or as a privilege and not as a necessity. Now, if you look at it, today it's a top priority for most organizations. And for some organizations, it's the only option. Keeping that in the background, one has to look at the work from home has become vital for business continuity and also for organization and employee sustenance. We are now in the third quarter of work from home. Many organizations are still in different stages of preparedness for work from home, and many employees are in different frames of mind to work from home. I'm actually very pleased to share the findings of my study on this topic. This study was conducted during the second quarter when we were just in the midst of understanding what is work from home, trying to juggle family life and work life, meet deadlines and cope with the COVID-19. The findings of this study are only indicative. They are not conclusive, as any such study would throw light on. Again, the purpose of the study is to give us those pointers, those indicators, which would help us see maybe one or more of the findings of the study could be applicable to one group of employees or one segment of employees, a whole department. So to that extent, we hope that this study would add value to the knowledge base and also make our life much more easier as managers and employees in corporate Bahrain. Moving on, now we are looking at the main aim of this study was to examine the various challenges and benefits of work from home. For this purpose, I identified what are the challenges all over the world people are facing, the prominent ones, and the benefits are obvious. The benefits of work from home are quite obvious. That was the main aim of the study. Another important area which was very crucial for us is to assess if there are any similarities and differences among the different demographic segments that I studied. Now, the major demographic segments we took, of course, is the gender, and we looked at the position. What is there any difference in managers and non-managers? Now, for the purpose of this study, supervisors, team leaders, frontline managers, all were included under the group or the category of managers. We also looked at the generation-wise analysis, where currently, if you look at corporate Bahrain, like other parts of the world, we have four generations working. We have the baby boomers. These are those employees who are in the range, in the age group of 55, 56 and above. We have Generation X, who are in the age group of, say, 40 to 56. Of course, you have the millennials, who are in the age group of 23 to 39. And you have Generation Z, who are those employees who just graduated from a university and joined the workforce 23 years around that age and below. Then the other important objective of the study was to identify the preferences for work from home. COVID-19 will go, but work from home will stay in some form or shape. It's now time for us, we are in the third quarter of work from home, to see, are we going in the right direction? Is there something that we can do better? Or is there something that could give us more support where we can make the employee's life and the organization productivity better? Now, keeping that premise in mind, we'll move forward. We are looking at the methodology here. The methodology for this simple study, it was a very simple study, but it was required because we needed to have some idea what's happening in Bahrain. This was a very, what I would call as a very small attempt to contribute to the corporate Bahrain, how we can move with this work from home, which will remain in some form or shape in the future. The primary sources were a group of 250 employees. I used the convenience sample, and the response rate that I got was 84%. The secondary sources were also tapped, from which I was able to identify the major challenges the world is facing with work from home and the benefits which people all over the world are looking at. The data collection tool was a very simple online survey questionnaire, which was administered during the months of July and August 2020. Now, there was an equal representation. One second. I hope you are able to see my slideshow. Yes? Okay. Thank you, Hannah. Anyway, since you missed it, let me just take you through so you need to see some of the, at least when you're looking at the virtual or the screen, something more colorful. This was what I was speaking about, the aim and study, scope of the study, the methodology that we had in mind, and then the different demographic segment representation. If you look at it, 49% of the respondents were females and 51% were males. It was a convenient sample. Position-wise, the respondents, we had 55% respondents who belong to the managerial position and 45% who belong to the non-managerial position. And I was quite pleased to see the representation of the four generations. It somewhat falls in place with the workforce ratio that you may have in your organization. Baby boomers, we are talking about is 19% of the representation was from baby boomers. We had 32% Generation X. We had 33% millennials, and the Generation Z, about 16% constituted the Generation Z. The representation is quite fair, and it really gave us some input into the findings that we had. Was really very fair based on this kind of a representation. Now, to a very important question, like 20% of the respondents didn't have a work from home policy at all. Yeah, didn't have a work from home policy at all. We had about 26% had work from home for some jobs only. Of course, it depends whether it's sales, it could be the what we call as the frontline workers. It could be the first response team that we are looking at. So again, organizations had a differentiated work from home policy as well. 54% started work from home policy only during COVID-19, which is expected, because work from home was not considered as a priority, as I already mentioned earlier. Now, another important aspect which we had to find out was with regard to the support received during work from home. The support that most of the respondents, 80% of the respondents, indicated that they received support from IT departments, which is again expected, because IT is, this is all about technology, virtual working and working from home involved, having that kind of a technological updation. 80% have indicated the IT support they have got. Now, if you look at it, you have 59% saying that they received continuous communication and updation, and 50% received manager support. In this crucial time, we would have expected the continuous communication and updation and manager support to be a little more effective. Maybe a bigger percentage should have indicated it. And we look at it that less than 50% of the respondents were able to get the support they wanted from HR and their colleagues. Again, HR also was juggling with trying to bring in work from home systems in place, and colleagues were also at the same time trying to cope with all the things that are happening around them, and also trying to cope with the technological issues of work from home. Most probably that could be the reason for this kind of a less than 50% of the support respondents saying that they received the support. And only 20% of the respondents indicated that they had some kind of a workstation equipment support. Now, in this crucial time, it's quite important for organizations to give some kind of a support. Now, 2% of the respondents indicated that they had financial support, which unfortunately that didn't come up here. Financial support, only 2% received some kind of a financial support. Now, when we look at support, it could be in the form of talking to the employees and seeing if they have got a workspace at home, or just encouraging employees and looking at the ergonomical fit. And also, if possible, some organizations, what they've also done is they've tied up with some office equipment organizations to get some installments, some loans for the employees to buy the workstation. So support of this sort, maybe in the future one may have to look at it, because this is quite important. And employees really do not have that kind of a knowledge, because all the time office equipment and office space was taken care by professionals. Now working from home required a workstation, workspace and office space where employees may not have that kind of expertise or may not have that kind of a pattern in their mind. So this is with regard to the support received during work from home. It is more or less balanced in all ways. The challenges of work from home basically were 14 challenges were listed, as you can see here. The first one was too many, it's not in any particular order. It's not sequenced according to importance or whatever it is. It's just put there, as just listed there. Too many distractions, not having access to the tools or information needed for the job, as the respondents were from manufacturing organization and from service organization. For them, it was essential to have some tools or to have access to equipment. Internet connectivity, because office internet, organizational internet, corporate internet, Wi-Fi is quite different from the home packages that we get. Childcare was quite important as well. And we are looking at the most important, the one which has been flagged up as a major challenge, the social isolation that people are experiencing because of work from home. And then communication with colleagues, is it harder? Was that a challenge for respondents? Sickness, because COVID-19 is all about sickness or helping others who are sick, was another challenge which was listed. Keeping a regular schedule, that was really a challenge for a lot of people. Again, we are looking at the general anxiety about the impact of coronavirus, you know, how this is impacting us, and people becoming anxious about themselves and about the dear ones, loved ones. looking at the some of we are seeing all those YouTube videos and WhatsApp forwards, we're keeping family members away from workspace, especially during virtual meetings, is definitely a challenge. Not to forget that the work has invaded the home space. It has invaded the family environment. Now, the employee may be quite attuned to be very productive and self-disciplined, but the family members also need that kind of a discipline. So in the beginning, there was a lot of challenge going on, especially during the second quarter when the study was conducted. But now as we reach the third quarter and we are moving on to the fourth quarter of work from home, things are becoming more stable. You know, family members, they're able to understand each other's needs and they're able to give each other the space. It's not just workspace they need space from the family members as well, the employees. Colleagues not responding on time, again, the reason could be family members or childcare, coping with the technological issues of work from home. This is the next challenge is quite major, not having workspace, workstation at home. We already looked at the support that the organizations are giving the employees. The major challenge which came up, which was really highlighted, work requests from managers or colleagues after scheduled work hours was a big challenge, or colleagues and managers thinking that they can make work requests at their convenience. So this is something which is irking a lot of employees. And then, of course, the major thing which is topmost in the minds of the whole world is the concern about job security. These are the 14 challenges which were listed. Now, the analysis that we have done, the findings, if you look at the position-wise analysis, it is no major differentiation in the challenges faced. We have got work requests from managers and colleagues after scheduled work hours. Well, if you look at this, color code, the green one is number one challenge. The number one challenge for managers and gender wise, you look at the males and females as well, the respondents, all of them have indicated that they were receiving work requests from managers and colleagues after scheduled hours or at their convenience. Whereas for non-managers, this was not that much. It was looked at, the first challenge was not this. The first challenge for them was not having workspace. The second challenge is blue coded. The second challenge for the non-managers was work request. That was the second challenge. And for managers, the second challenge was not having workspace, workstation at home. And we are looking at the second challenge for both the gender, the male and the female, was keeping a regular schedule. So there was no gender difference when it came to maintaining regular timings or work from home here, because both were having maybe most probably the same family commitments as we look at here. Now moving on to the third challenge that has been identified. We are looking at the third challenge, gender-wise, it's the same. We're keeping family members away. Again, this ties in very nicely with the second challenge, which they have talked about, where they are talking about not able to have a regular schedule. This ties in with maybe family members not able to keep away from the workspace or the workstation as well. And interestingly, gender-wise, the first, the second and the third challenges are same. There's no gender difference when it came to these challenges which they faced. These were the topmost challenges faced by both male and female respondents. Now, when it comes to the fourth challenge for the gender, the males and the females, we are talking about the male respondents, again, not having a workstation at home. And for the females, it was not having access to information needed for the job. The fifth challenge, of course, was colleagues' communication is harder for the males and too many distractions at home, females. Maybe it's a gender identified role which has made them, which prompted them to give a higher percentage for this kind of a challenge. Now, the conclusion is, before we move on, for the managers, if you look at it, the five challenges are more or less similar. The five top challenges which they have identified. The second one is the same, colleagues not responding on time, whether it's a manager or non-manager. Obviously, if it's a colleagues, it could be a co-manager, it could be a co-employee, it could be a co-team member. Everybody is facing the same challenge. It was a fourth challenge identified by both people working in different positions. And we are looking again at the third challenge, communications with colleagues is harder. This ties in very well. If communication with colleagues is harder, obviously they're not responding on time. They both go together. So it makes a lot of sense for us to look at it that way. The fourth challenge, again, we are looking at here is the fifth challenge we are looking at here is internet connectivity, which was highlighted by non-managers and managers. Now, these are the details of it, but the final analysis is there is no position-wise differentiation in the challenge faced. All are facing the same challenges. The top five challenges have been the same for managers and non-managers. The four major challenges you can see which have been identified, and also there's no gender-wise difference in challenges faced. Both males and females experience the same three major challenges. So we can safely say, based on the study of 210 respondents, that we don't have to differentiate male, female, or manager, non-manager when we are looking at the challenges faced during work from home. Everybody is experiencing somewhat the same major challenges. The other challenges also have been experienced, but in differing percentages, as you can see. Childcare has come up quite less. Sickness or helping others who are sick has very few respondents have even opted for it. This is very interesting, especially during COVID-19 time, or considering our strict measures that we have followed in our country. Now, this is a very important analysis for us. Moving on, we are looking at the generation-wise analysis with regard to the challenges faced during work from home. Here, there is a significant difference. But one thing is standing out very glaring is work requests from managers and colleagues after scheduled work hours or at their convenience is again coming up as a number one challenge. This is a topmost challenge, whether they belong to different generations, male, female, manager, non-manager. So here is something which has been flagged up. This is an area where we need to focus on and see how we can make sure that this is not going to be such a challenge for our employees in the future. We also are looking at the second challenge. We are looking at Generation X and millennials talking about not having workspace and workstation at home. Strangely, for Generation Z, this did not pose such a challenge. Most probably, being digital natives and belonging to the younger generation, they may have already created some kind of a workstation, you know, with the technology that they have. Too many distractions also did not bother the younger generation. When we are talking about too many distractions, if you look at it, baby boomers and Generation X, the older generation, were more prone to be distracted at home than the millennials and Generation Z. Again, this could be what we call as that baby boomers and Generation X have spent more time in corporates, have spent more time in organizations, and they still didn't get the hang of how not to allow distractions to bother them. Yeah. And again, when we're looking at Generation X and millennials, strangely, they were more concerned about job security. If you look here, they have identified it as the fifth challenge, as the fourth challenge. Job security was playing on the minds of Generation X and millennials. Again, if you look at the age group of this generation, they're in the age group of 23 to say 54. That is the peak time of their career in the corporates, and this is the time they really need to feel secure about their jobs. And surprisingly, you see that baby boomers were not really that much concerned about job security. And of course, when we talk about Generation Z, it was not again a major concern. It's the age group again we are looking at here. For baby boomers and a Generation Z, not having access to information was a challenge. It's quite paradoxical that the older generation and the younger generation are looking at, they're having a similar mindset, which was quite an interesting find for us. Baby boomers experience anxiety about impact of coronavirus. Of course, because of the age category, once again, if you look at it, it was a number two challenge for them. They were more anxious, not about the job security, but about most probably their health and their very survival also because of the updates, medical updates coming up saying that this age group is more prone. social isolation and communication, which we are looking at, was more a challenge with millennials and Generation Z. These are the younger generation, and they definitely need to have that kind of social interactions, and they are finding it quite challenging. They found it quite challenging. They need to, though they are very much on social media, the social isolation is more about physical interaction rather than social connection. Because I believe that the words that we are using, like social distancing and social isolation, it's really not. With social media, this was a term which would apply maybe 2 decades ago. But as of now, with social media, there's always some kind of a connection going on. Connectivity is there. Younger generation, socially, we are very much connected with each other. Rather than that, maybe if you use the word physical isolation, that would make more sense, most probably. So definitely, there is a significant difference when it comes to the challenges faced by the different generations in the organization, in corporate Bahrain. Maybe we have to be mindful about this. And one thing which is standing out very glaring is work requests from managers and colleagues, because we still didn't figure out how work from home timings is going to play out. Maybe in the end, I'll be talking a little more about it. So as of now, we'll just move forward. What are the benefits of work from home? Now, benefits are quite straightforward and very simple. We just categorize them under six headings: saving commute time, more focus, flexible working, work-life balance, personal and family care, less stress. Again, looking at the segment-wise significance, if there's any significant difference segment-wise, the demographic segment that we have taken, the females and males, they had four benefits. They listed the same four benefits which they reaped during work from home. The only difference that you'll be able to see is that less stress. The male respondents have identified that the benefit that they experienced is less stress. And the females, the benefit that they found during work from home was more focus. That's the significant difference that you can see between male respondents and female respondents. Now, when it comes to managers and non-managers, we are able to see that the five benefits, top benefits listed by them are same. They have got flexible working, was a benefit, saving commute time. It's only interchangeable. For some, it was the first benefit. For some, it was the second benefit. But nevertheless, it is coming under the top five benefits. So there's no significant difference when it comes to the positions with regard to the benefits that we reaped during work from home. The interesting aspect is here. Again, when it comes to the generation Y analysis, different generation analysis, we are looking at there's not much of a difference when it comes to baby boomers and Generation X. They had somewhat the same benefits, but maybe the order was slightly changed. Saving commute time was listed. Saving commute time came up as a benefit for all, for males and females. It came up even for managers and non-managers. It has come up for all the four generations. Now, considering the country and the traffic that we experienced at that time, so this really looked like a real benefit that they were able to see, they were reaping the benefit of saving commute time. Saving commute time also meant that they saved up 2 or 3 hours of their time, which they could spend on work or which they could spend with their families. So that really came up. Flexible working, which the corporate Bahrain, most of corporate Bahrain is not really accustomed to flexible working. Flexible working has come up again as one of the major benefits which has been reaped. This is what we have been looking for, and work from home, COVID-19 has ushered in this flexible working, which is definitely a requirement nowadays for all employees. Personal and family care figured, because when there's flexible working, personal and family care, it ties in very nicely with it. You have more timing you have more time at home, so you are able to spend more time with your family and take care of yourself as well. Work-life balance, of course, when we talk about flexible working and personal and family care, work-life balance will follow. It is just a given. that work-life balance is something that we have to consider. Baby boomers and Generation X have identified more focus. So have the millennials and Generation Z. More focus also was there. The only thing that we found difference was in Generation Z, which identified that one of the benefits that they reaped during this work from home was less stress. Presumably, they are just new to the corporate. They are used to having a more independent, or rather, they lived life on their terms till now. Once they entered the corporate barren, of course, one has to be more fall in line with the system that the organization wants. So most probably for that reason, less stress was identified by Generation Z. So overall, the benefits were quite good. And these are the major benefits we have been looking for, and we got it during the work from home. Now, at this stage, what one has to look at is many people are looking for work-life balance, but work from home has not given them that work-life balance. That is why the challenges, if you look at the challenges that they face during work from home, it contradicts the work-life balance benefit that they were able to reap. So we have to look at how we as organization can make things happen in a better manner, where work-life balance is really enjoyed by all our employees in whatever form or shape they want it. Another important area that we had looked at is, now COVID-19 is here to stay. When we talk about COVID-19 is here to stay, it's here to stay for the next 2 or 3 months, and it will go away after that, hopefully. We all hope that with the progress that is being made and with the awareness that has been created, but still, organizations now know that work from home works for them. Organizations also have reaped a lot of benefits by certain costs which they have saved up. And employees have definitely seen that during the first 2 quarters, work from home was definitely a challenge. But now as we are moving into the 3rd quarter, as I told, and now from December, January, February, we'll be moving into the 4th quarter of work from home. What could be the preference of employees, all the different demographic segments that we have? What could be their preference? Very simple, we are looking at it. The preferences were again somewhat the same. Most of them have said, if you look at the female respondents, it hovered around. It anchored around half the time, having work from home half the time, having work from home most of the time. It was just interchangeable. And then sometimes, what figured out mostly was half the time, most of the time, sometimes. The only place that we found a little bit of a difference, where there was a significant difference, was with baby boomers. If you look at all the other segments, whether female respondents or male managers or non-managers, Generation Z and millennials and Generation X, all of them have given half the time or most of the time as one of their top preferences. But baby boomers have given it as sometimes. They gave it only as sometimes. This probably could be the reason. This probably could be due to the reason that baby boomers have spent more, maybe 3 decades or more in the corporate barren. And they have that much of that many years of experience, also balancing work and life, and able to take a family and personal care. So their preference is not that much. Maybe sometimes it depends on what they want. Sometimes they're okay with it, or half the time, but not most of the time. So that's a very interesting finding that may help us in looking at how our different generation employees are looking at their preference for the future. What do they prefer in the future? Now, this is the 3 main areas that we have looked at. We looked at the challenges and benefits among the different demographic segments. We analyzed the challenges faced by the male, the gender-wise analysis, the position-wise analysis, and the generation-wise analysis. We also looked at the preferences of the gender, the position, and the generations. Now, having these findings in mind, and specifically to these findings, there are certain areas we need to focus on in order to make work from home a better, a much happier experience for the employer and for the employee. These focus areas that we are looking at here are at the center of it is employee well-being. Now, what I would like to stress here is, it's better before we recede, into mental health and we regress into mental health issues and initiatives. I think if we progress and if we move towards employee well-being, that's the first step. This is a matter of being proactive, rather mental health is being reactive. So if you are proactive and just try to maintain the mental, what we talk about, the mental well-being and the physical well-being of our employees, maybe it'll go a long way in helping us minimize some of the what we call as a disengagement that we can have with our employees. It can reduce the frustration of employees. It can definitely go a long way in helping the management team in having better relationship with the employees and getting more work done, and having which of course would result in productivity and profitability. At the center of it, I see employee well-being. Employee well-being now is not just employee mental well-being, it's also physical well-being. It's the employee's financial well-being. It's the employee's what we call as spiritual well-being. It's the employee's well-being in all aspects of the society. Very simple tips which we can follow. We already have all this in place, but maybe we just need to reorient and have some kind of a look at things from a different frame now. Reinforce work ethics. Now, work ethics are not going to change because it's virtual working or it's work from home. Work ethics, if they are the same, they are just transferable. If somebody is committed and somebody is ready to meet all deadlines, and if some employee is very cooperative and is able to give the best to the organization, even working from home, work ethics remain the same. All that we need to do is, at some stage, I believe, during the first quarter and second quarter of work from home, that if we started in March in Bahrain, if you remember, March, April, May, and then June, July, August, we were still struggling because we were juggling. And it appeared like we were not being ethical with regard to our jobs and our profession. Not so. There were a lot of issues happening from the community health-wise, and there were a lot of issues happening about insecurity. So work ethics is something that we have to reinforce. One thing which I would like to stress here is being respectful and being mindful of other people's time and their family time and family space is very important. Work from home for some people, instead of giving them the work-life balance, it has gone into the area of work-life blend. Now, work-life blend is not what we are looking at. Many people, many employees do not appreciate work-life blend. We 24/7, you have to be working. Okay, you can take care of your family issues. You can take care of your personal care. You're sitting at home. You're working from home. So do your own thing and then come and attend to the work. No, some don't prefer work-life blend. Some prefer work-life balance. I need to finish my work and I need to have the balance where I go into my personal care, I go into my family time and space. So work ethics means, and if we reinforce the work ethics, having this in mind, being respectful of people's timing and being mindful of their family care and personal care, we would definitely diminish the top challenge which has been identified by all the respondents about managers, not employee colleagues and managers sending work requests after scheduled work hours. It shouldn't be like that. And then we are looking at building virtual teams. Teams are teams. And when we are working virtually, the only hiccup we could have some starting problems or some teething problems with regard to technology and with regard to bringing certain self-discipline. Teams will work as teams. So again, then we are talking about virtual teams. Let's be very careful about what are your communication access methods. What I personally noted and what I heard from a lot of other people working in corporate Bahrain is you have to go for the time-tested communication access method in your organization. That shouldn't change. Email, supposing your organization is looking at emails as the first point of access to your employees, continue doing so. If you have an official WhatsApp group and that's what is your preferred communication access method, then please inform the employees about it. Now I see with Microsoft Teams, has become a communication method, but maybe you need to inform employees. Now somebody like me who's only used to emails and say WhatsApp or phone calls, I may not be watching my Microsoft Teams communicate chat box all the time. So then what would happen is maybe I'm delaying my work, or the employee is not able to communicate well. There'll be some kind of a friction, and that's why the teams will break up, and that's why a work ethics issue comes, professionalism comes. It's all a matter of establishing and communicating. Okay, in our organization, email is first, official WhatsApp group is second, and Microsoft Teams is third, or for urgent things is. If this becomes clear, all employees will fall in line, and no employee can afford to make an excuse that I did not see the email or I did not respond to it. Because if you look at the challenges, most of the respondents have said communication with colleagues is harder, and then colleagues are not cooperating. All this type of thing you can easily eliminate by having the good communication access methods. Redesigning jobs is another important area. When we talk about redesigning jobs, if work from home is here to stay, we are looking at there may be certain parts of the job which can be done from home, and certain parts of the job which can be done from office. Even in the future, you may have to no longer the same job description or the same job system is going to work. The position profile is going to work. We are talking about, okay, this part we can work from home, and this part we can work from office, where the organization can benefit from the work from home costs, and the employee can benefit from the personal and family care of work from home. Having differentiated initiatives is the key here. We have seen that we have four generations working currently. What I could only tell at this stage is if each organization does its own small survey and look at what works for your organization or what doesn't work, accordingly you can come out with a blanket initiative, or you can have differentiated initiatives based on the category of employees. And it's all about expectation management. Both the parties, you know, we are talking about whoever it is, your colleagues, managers and all, everybody who are involved in this work from home, we have to set our expectations, and we have to communicate our expectations. Without that, we may not be getting the results that we want. Managing these expectations is very, very important. So just to add, it's all about employee well-being, and at all times we have to have the employee well-being, not just the physical, but also the mental. So we don't regress, we don't recede into mental health, because that's coming up very strongly nowadays. Organizations are reacting and having what we call as employee assistance programs and all that. Maybe you'll be able to avoid that if you are able to just take care of these simple things that we need to do. If we get our basics right, we don't have to go for such initiatives at all. Now the takeaway for us, how are we doing for time? Yeah, the takeaway is, we are looking at, simply speaking, I believe that we shouldn't be using the word work from home, because work and home don't bode well. They don't go together. Home is home, because traditionally or till now, all generations, work is work and home is home. Now, I like this terminology which has come up, which most organizations are using. If you say work from home office, then I'm very clear that I have a home, my office is at home, and there'll be certain timings for that office, and I need a workstation for that, and the family members know that I'm in my home office rather than traveling, rather than driving to my office, physical office, which is far away. This will help a lot. It will also have an indirect impact on the employee well-being and discipline of the employee and the managers both together. It's an integral part of people management planning. Look at it at work from home office rather than work from home. These kind of words definitely have an indirect impact on the mind of, in the mental state of people, even in the family members. You tell your child, I'm in the home office, the child would understand because it's office. The word office comes there. That's where professionalism comes. When you put the word office there, professionalism comes for the employee, and the family members also know what are the boundaries, and that they can't intrude on the home office timing and space. Virtual working has started, but what I see is missing, and I keep telling whoever interacts with me on these issues that we have to look at the performance dimensions related to virtual working. We have not yet come up with the performance dimensions. I'm not saying it's going to change dramatically or significantly, but there will be a certain change in your performance dimensions, your standards that you have to look at. And see how best you can help out your employees with regard to the performance dimensions. Communicate to them from now. so that they know that, yeah, I need to, I did not respond to a Microsoft Teams chat. I was not aware about it. Now the dimensions have changed. I'm going to be appraised on all these type of access points, especially communication access points become more important when we have this virtual working. Definitely multi-generational management techniques are needed now. One size doesn't fit all, as we have seen. There was a significant difference when it came to challenges and benefits among the different generations. We need to, as paradoxical as it may sound, we need to have an integrated goal approach. We may be having blanket solutions. We may be having group-wise initiatives. Now, we are in the crossroads. 5 years ago, we did not have Generation Z. We had only three generations working with us. 5 years from now, we will not be having baby boomers working with us. We'll only be having the younger generation. 5 years from now, digital migrants will walk away from your organization. They are no longer working, they are no longer attached to the corporate body. You'll only have digital natives working in it. So you need to look at what type of policies you need to bring in, whether work from home office is the only thing in the future. It's not an option. It's going to be a top priority because you have all digital natives. 5 years from now, you'll only have digital natives. So that is the now these 5 years are very crucial for us because we have four generations working with us. So it would be in our interest to see maybe we could have a generational, we could have a blanket policy covering 50%, a 50% blanket policy for all the generation and a differentiated policy, 50% differentiated policy according to the generation. Baby boomers, okay, for you, I can allow you to work from home, or Generation Z, we have this type of policy for them. Now I think it's going to be blended people management mechanisms. It's no longer we had these time-tested, one-only policies in people management. We need to have blended people management mechanisms because 5 years from now, things are going to change significantly for the corporate body. And on top of it, it's the last but not the least, and I don't think we need to emphasize more on it. What is required is a positive culture and making your employees feel safe, you know, not creating a fear psychosis about job insecurity. I mean, everybody knows it. It's at the back of their mind, but we don't have to harp on it on a daily basis. Creating a positive culture, seeing how best we can extend a helping hand to our employees and see how we can give them support with regard to the whether it's technology or even just calling them and asking, are you comfortable? Are you having any disturbances? In what way I can help you out? Any way in which you think it's possible to create a positive and safe environment is the need of the day. And I just would like to leave you at this stage with this thought that if you have a positive culture, all these challenges that we face would look very simple for us as a management team, as an employee team, because both managers and non-managers, everybody's experiencing the same challenges. We would like to get more benefit from this work from home office culture. And definitely what we require is a safe environment. It's not just because of COVID-19. Now it's also, we are slowly moving, with my years of experience with people management, mental health has become a major issue. If we create that safe environment, we will definitely be taking care of the employee mental well-being. We don't have to go deep. We don't have to go deep into mental health issues. And that's my concern now at this stage. This is my concern. Now, I only hope these findings are useful to you in some way. Now, again, I would reiterate the findings of this study are indicative. And if any of the findings would help you in understanding how to deal with your employees better, or maybe you could come up with your own mechanisms and methods, how you can deal with work from home office. That's very, very important because it's here to stay. You're going to have only digital natives in the future in 3 to 5 years time. It's from now you have, and also not just with the digital natives, with the digital disruption that is happening currently and the transformation that organizations are going through, we definitely have to look at blended people management mechanisms. And you'd only be looking at three generations in 5 years' time, hopefully for another 10 years. And then again, we do not know another generation, you would classify employees, you would definitely have a fourth generation coming in. For the next 5 years, you have four. The next the 15 years, you will have only three in your organization. After that, you will again have to look at how you can make it better for your employees. It's always work in progress. People management is always work in progress. And as of now, our work in progress must be positive and must be safe. At this stage now, I think, Hannah, I can take the questions. Hannah, I'll be taking the questions now. If you have any questions.
Yes.
Hopefully I'll be able to answer that. Yeah.
Any questions, you can answer them.
Yeah, again, now I have a question here. Why do men most of the time look at it? See, now what I would like to add to you here, if you looked at the analysis, and I would like to state here at this moment, this article, this study has been published in a peer-reviewed journal from UK. We'll be putting it up on BIBF website. We have got a research area there. You can check it up. What we have to look at is, somebody asked, why is managers want most of the time? If you look at the analysis, even Generation X, they found keeping a regular work schedule very difficult. Considering that Generation X, the age category, they may be dealing with very complex projects. They may be in positions where they are handling their spearheading initiatives. So for them, I think the complexity and the target achievement that they have, they have reached a position of power. So keeping a regular schedule may be difficult. So most of the time, one reason could be more focus, as they rightly indicated, and it also could be that they are finding it more productive and they've seen the benefits of it. That's at this moment, that's the answer I could give you. Here we are having various governments are considering to put up a tax on work from as now as leverage to office city employees will get. Do you think it's the idea of work-life balance will deteriorate as it will impact the employees financially, considering that many see it as a... Yes, definitely, it will impact, yeah. Again, now look at it, as I just said, we are looking at mental health. Now, at one time, governments are thinking of taxing people who are working from home, and the governments again are spending a lot of money on initiatives of employee well-being, employee mental health. Now, why do we need to do that? We have to wait and see why should we tax them? What way it is costing us? And why should the work from home, which is a requirement, by the way, as I said, it's not an option anymore. It's going to be a top priority. Don't forget the digitalization, the digital disruptions that are happening. And if some studies, I don't recollect now at the moment, I was reading that all over the world, major organizations, 60% of the physical locations, they have eliminated. They are just doing away with physical locations. And you have Jack Ma, the Alibaba, they have really shown us that even without any physical offices, that we can do a lot of wonders. That's one example which is coming to my mind now. So it's all about virtual working in the future. So we cannot have this kind of a tax. One has to really think about it, but I'm not the competent authority to answer that. But in my opinion, in my view, I don't think it's the right way to deal with things. Definitely, I do agree with you, what you are saying. Yeah. And now, since we are running out of time, Hannah, should we close the session?
We can still do one more question if you
would like. Is a question coming up? I see there are certain. No. Okay. Now, for all those who are still here, I need to tell you is which I should have mentioned it earlier in my presentation. Is please be aware. I'm just not talking about mental health very lightly. We have to take it very seriously. There's something called as digital burnout happening. And we are still in the third quarter of work from home, virtual working. There's a digital burnout happening. and by fourth quarter, and if it's work from home, will break in digital burnout. So we need to take into account. Now people started digital detox. Digital detox by having some simple tips, like for example, we are talking about just your screen time management. Your screen time management, just keep away, move away. That is why this work-life blend is not going to help us. One new thing has started is digital burnout. Work-life blend is not going to help us all the time with devices, technological devices. At some time, the screen time must be minimized and we need to keep away from devices. And we, as of now, we don't know what we don't know. Where the virtual working, how it's going to impact the mental state and the physical health of virtual workers. We are still in the beginning. We are still in its infancy. This study is still in its infancy. So it may take another 2 to 3 and 3 to 5 years, as I see, if we conduct more studies, we'll be able to come out with what could be the dangers. Work from home office, the answer is, I haven't any idea about the statistics that is there, the statistics. Thank you for your questions. Any other questions, Anna? Should we close the session or we wait? Yeah. Thank you so much. Again, it's a virtual session and I know again you're looking at the screen. I try to put some color into it so that you don't look at a blank screen. Yeah. Thank you very much for your participation and your attendance, and stay safe. Thank you. I can't hear.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Vijay, and everyone with all your questions. We appreciate you being here. I hope the session was very useful. I personally heard great, great tips and ideas from Dr. I like the work from home office idea instead of yes. just work from home. So thank you, Doctor. So to all the attendees, to keep up to date with our upcoming webinars, events, please visit the BIBF website, bibf.com, or visit our social media accounts. This session is recorded. We will be publishing it online if anyone missed it. You can find it on our YouTube channel or the IBF website, and we will send it to all of you who attended. So thanks again for joining us today. We will all see you next time in our other events.
Okay. Thank you, Hannah. Can you hear me?